The new Minister of Transport has moved to stop or reverse changes to speed limits around the country that were first put forward as part of the previous government's Road to Zero campaign. It'll mean schools have variable speed limits around pick-up and drop-off times. Simeon Brown is the new Minister of Transport. Good morning, congratulations on your appointment.
Good morning, Jack.
What is the potential downside to changing speed limits outside schools?
Well, what we want to have is the ability for people to get where they need to go quickly and safely. One of the key areas, though, that we need to ensure that there is safety is for young children arriving or being picked up at schools. And so we're not going to continue the last government's blanket approach to reducing speed limits. Mm. We have targeted interventions. And as part of that, we'll require schools to have a slower speed limit at those times of pickup and drop-off, which a lot of other countries do as well.
So what are the potential downsides to having variable speed limits outside schools?
Well, ultimately, it's focused. It's a targeted approach. It's about actually saying, I don't think there's any downsides.
There's zero downsides whatsoever.
I think it's about making sure we are improving the safety at the time when children are being picked up or dropped off outside schools. And this is about ensuring that the traffic's moving slower and there's improved safety at those times. But actually, the rest of the time, people need to get where they need to go. And so we don't want to take a blanketed approach like the last government, where there's whole swathes of Auckland are now 30 kilometres per hour. And if you go visit those suburbs, I'll tell you what, not many people, including the buses sometimes, are actually doing 30 kilometres per hour.
So just to be clear, as Transport Minister, you think there are zero downsides to having variable speed limits outside schools?
Well,
that's my question.
Well, I think it's about the balanced approach that we need in this circumstances.
So my question is there a downside to having variable speed limits outside schools as opposed to a blanket approach?
Well, the other option is you have to have a blanket reduction in speed limits. And I'll tell you one of the issues there is if you go to some of those...
Is there a potential downside to having variable speed limits outside schools?
The issue you've got is where you do go to those suburbs which have got the 30 kilometre per hour blanket speed limit reductions, very few of the cars you actually observe are going at that speed limit. And so you're not actually getting the behaviour change that may have been intended. So we need to take a balanced approach which understands the need for people to get where they need to go, but particularly around those times when children have been picked up or dropped off at school, we want to improve the safety.
Sometimes kids go to school early, sometimes they stay late.
And that's why it'll be 8 to 9.30 in the morning, 2.30 to 4 o'clock in the afternoon. That's a reasonable balanced approach that we want to take to this.
So what sort of productivity gains are you getting from introducing those variable speed limits, specifically outside of schools?
Well, what we're doing is we're not simply just slowing the entirety of the network down, which is what the last government's approach has been to traffic. It's been about slowing people down. You've had blanket speed limit, 30 kilometre per hour speed limit reductions. You've had arterial roads being slowed down. They wanted to slow the entire state highway network.
My question is what productivity gains?
To 80 kilometres per hour. There is increased travel times when you reduce speed limits. Now, it depends on the actual circumstances of where you might put that particular blanket approach. But we're saying is we want to keep traffic moving at reasonable speeds, but make sure that during those pick-up and drop-off times we are keeping... And look, I mean, Jack, the last government... I mean, Chris Hipkins even said that he was going to throw...
The last government are gone.
He was going to chuck it on the bonfire. That's what he thought of this.
You're in government now.
We're making the changes New Zealanders voted for.
Minister, Auckland Transport tested how much time was lost for journeys in urban areas with lower speed limits outside schools. Have you seen that research?
Yes, so there's been a range of estimates.
So what did Auckland Transport find for the changes outside schools?
Well, it depends on which particular zone.
For 20-minute average journeys, how much time was saved by having the higher speed limits outside schools?
Well, it depends on which school zone you might put it on.
So what did Auckland Transport find?
Well, it'd be a range. So it could have been 20 seconds, could have been a minute.
So they found on average. This is their,
there's a range on these things.
Yeah, so they
it
found
depends on the context of the streets. And
they found... Over a 20 minute average trip, it saved on average 15 seconds.
And you've got to add that up across the cumulative number of journeys that are being taken by Aucklanders every single day. And what we're saying is if you're going past a school when children are being picked up or dropped off at the start of the day, at the end of the day, there will be a slower journey time past those schools. But through the rest of the day, we're not going to take a blanket approach to this. And as I said earlier, you go to those parts of Auckland which have had the 30 kilometres per hour blanket approaches put in place, and you don't see many people following that because it's not reasonable. So we need to take a balanced approach, and then make sure where you do have those slower speed limits during pick-up and drop-off times, you then enforce it.
Okay. You've published a new draft transport GPS. So in what ways would you say that it most significantly changes the transport modal balance from the previous government's plans?
Well, we're focused on improving economic growth and productivity, something which wasn't part of the previous government's a draft transport policy statement. We wanted to bring back the Roads of National Significance, which was a successful program to unlock economic growth in this country by building high quality roading infrastructure between our city, in our cities and between our regions. But there's also an investment that we're making into reliable public transport, building on the investment the last national government did in the City Rail Link, electrifying the rail network here in Auckland. We want to build on that through rapid bus transit, and that's the direction of travel we're taking.
So walking and cycling funding is halved, right? So in terms of a modal shift, you've changed the shift.
Well, there's actually, if you look at Phil Twyford's final GPS back in 2021, our upper limit for walking and cycling is actually higher.
Right, than what I'm going to the one that was in place last year.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. It's less than that, absolutely. Great.
So when you were here during the election campaign, I asked you about the accuracy of your transport costings, and I asked repeatedly if you'd accounted for inflation. And you brushed aside those concerns at the time. You said you'd taken an economically prudent approach to costings with the information you had available. So when NZTA costed your project in November, did they find that your party's costings were accurate?
Well, there is a range of estimates that they provided in terms of what those...
What do they find
But when we took what we took to the election was the most recent up-to-date information, as I said when I was here. But we've also made it very clear that we're going to need a range of funding and financing tools in order to deliver the infrastructure.
Sorry, that's not my question.
And we spoke about this last time here as well. We need to look at a whole range of ways to fund and finance the infrastructure in New Zealand.
So my question was, despite all of the concerns that were raised during the election campaign, and the scrutiny that was put over your costings, and the questions about properly accounting for inflation, when NZTA costed your projects, did they find your costings were accurate?
Well, they presented a range of what those costings would be.
And did they find that your costings were accurate?
Well, there was a range of estimates for each of those different projects.
And did their range find that your range was accurate?
Well, the reality is there has been cost increases in transport infrastructure. And part of that is because there's been scope increase. Part of that's because it's taking longer and harder to consent things in New Zealand. The consent conditions that are being imposed are adding significant cost. And that's why, as a government, we're going through all of those issues to actually say, if we're going to be able to build and deliver the infrastructure New Zealand needs, whether that's public transport or whether that's roading, we actually need to get it back to what is the core purpose of that infrastructure that we're trying to do. And I'll give you an example.
This is really important. I understand what you're trying to do. I've got a question here. There was a lot of scrutiny on those costings. A lot of people said you haven't properly accounted for inflation, the consenting issues that you have raised. You said, no, we're the party of fiscal discipline, we're the party of economic prudence. We've got this right. So if you just take the average range from NZTA's costings versus the ones you took to the election, how inaccurate were you?
Well, as I said, there's a range of estimates within...
So if you take the average.
Well, the reality is there's been a range of estimates, and what they've made very clear,
What was the average? How inaccurate were you by the average?
Well, I'll put it this way. There is a number of things that I've been presented advice over which has been causing significant cost increases and which we as a government are focused on dealing with. And so consent conditions, and I use an example of a consent condition, which I think is absurd. There is a sea wall being built between Petone and Wellington where one of the consent conditions is for the New Zealand Transport Agency to build underwater sea pyramids as part of that. Now, that doesn't do anything to help build the sea wall, but they're required to spend huge amounts of money on things like that. Mount Messenger, NZTA has been required to spend $750,000 in perpetuity on pest control and thousands of hectares of land they don't own around that project. We want to go through, and that's why one-stop shop fast-track consents is so critical to reducing costs so that we are paying for what we need as a country, as well as the innovative funding and financing opportunities we need to get things done.
So again, I'm just going to go back to that question. Using the average cost, the average forecasting that NZTA applied compared to your costings, how many billions of dollars short were you?
Well, we've always said we're going to need a range of funding and financing tools to be able to deliver the infrastructure
that
we need.
I'm sorry, Minister, that's not the question.
We've been very open about that.
Here's an opportunity to be open. How many billions of dollars short were you by your costings in the election campaign, taking the average?
Well, what we've said is we need a range of funding and financing opportunities
You're not being open and accurate. Sorry, Minister.
And we're going to go through the scope of these projects, but we're committed to delivering
them. How many billions of dollars short were you?
In terms of the...
The average costing.
Well, there's a range of estimates that were provided.
That's why we're going with the average. The average range.
And the average range...
How many billions short?
I mean, to be honest, I think this conversation is driving at the wrong element. We're focused on delivering. How many billions of dollars short were you? And we're focused on getting things done as a government.
How many billions of dollars short?
Well, I think the estimate that we took to the election was around 24. The lower range of what the NZTA has suggested, based on a bunch of assumptions, was around $30 billion. But as I've
said, so that's if you take that's $6 billion short. But if you take the average, it's about $16 billion short.
Well, as I've always said, though, we have always said we need to have new ways of funding and financing infrastructure in New Zealand. And that means whether it's public-private partnerships, whether it's build, own, operate, transfer, whether it's having increased use of tolling to actually fund this infrastructure. If you read my draft GPS, we have said as a government that we will, as a government, accept any recommendation to toll any new roads, because we need to make sure we have a user pays approach to building the infrastructure. And by doing so, we get that investment brought forward, because the alternative is we don't do anything. The alternative, Jack, is we don't do anything as a country, nothing gets built, and we don't reap the economic benefits that this country needs. And there's a report put together
There's lots of reports. You promised no new taxes going into the election. How much are vehicle registration fees increasing?
So we're going to increase the National Land Transport Fund component of the motor vehicle registration fee by $25 on the 1st of January next year.
Did you campaign
on another that? No, we didn't.
Right.
But ultimately, what we've put together is a GPS, which is focused on funding the transport system. It has a significant increase in making sure we reduce the number of potholes and improve and the resilience and maintenance of our network. But we have delivered in this draft GPS and our commitment not to increase fuel excise this year, next year, or in 2026.
It's 2027, it goes up. Page 15 of the GPS. Investment in walking and cycling should only take place where there is either clear benefit for increasing economic growth or clear benefit for improving safety, and demonstrated volumes of pedestrians and cyclists already exist. So does that mean that we have to wait for a road to have lots of cyclists using it and potentially risking their lives before we support a bike lane?
No, what we're saying here is I think a lot of New Zealanders have seen a lot of these very expensive cycleways being built, some of them costing tens of millions of dollars for relatively low patronage or number of cyclists using them.
There has to be an economic benefit.
So we want we want to see efficiency from that spend. So there's a range of the $70 to $130 million per year in the range. What we're saying is we want to see good value for money, and we want to see good benefit from that use. So that's the purpose of having some constraints added to that activity class.
So does that same rule regarding the return on investment apply for the roads of national significance?
Well, look, we'll absolutely be looking at all of those benefits as well.
Yeah, but does it apply? Because there has to be a clear benefit.
Absolutely, there will have to be clear benefit from those roads as well.
So have you initiated business cases for all of the roads of national significance?
They have not all started. I mean, you've got to remember, the last 6 years, the government turned off the Roads of National Significance program, and so we're having to turn that back on. They basically stopped building roads because they didn't believe in them. We know that roads are critically important to growing our economy, improving productivity, and improving safety. So there's a huge amount of work that the New Zealand Transport Agency has now got to start again so we can get this program underway.
So will all of those Roads of National Significance have to have a benefit-cost ratio of at least one in order to go ahead?
Well, the agency will go through that process, but I mean...
The favourite one that
you like to raise is the East-West Link, and the advice that was provided to the select committee by the New Zealand Transport Agency just a couple of months ago was it has a BCR of 1.9.
Great. So will all roads of national significance...
Well, they'll absolutely be going through that process.
But my question is, will you still support them if they don't have a benefit-cost ratio of at least one?
Well, we'll be going through that business case process. We'll be taking into account the wider economic benefits. If you look at Cambridge to Piarere, every year that's not constructed... Yeah. Not only is that an unsafe road that New Zealanders are travelling on,
but
we're losing $500 million of GDP, and according to a recent report by NZIER.
So we need to
get on and get things done in this country.
Sure, but I mean, there's no point in getting things done if we're not going to get value for money. That's the whole driving ethos behind your GPS, right? 100%,
and I just give you that example of Cambridge to Piarere, which people say, oh no, it's a low value piece of infrastructure.
Sure.
Well, it's $500 million of economic benefit we are not receiving because the last government cancelled that road.
And so my question is...
And a very dangerous alternative
that people
have to use. My question
is, will you commit to only building roads of national significance that the evidence shows will give us value for money by returning a business cost ratio of over one?
We'll absolutely be making sure they return value for money for taxpayers, but also, I'll put it this way. We're going to require that all new roads of national significance, where there is a recommendation to toll them, will be tolled to help maintain them, and to pay for the capital cost, because we believe in user pays, and we want to make sure that is a key part of delivering this infrastructure. And I'd also point out too, for those parts of New Zealand where we haven't necessarily put roads of national significance, by making sure that the ones which are told, we maintain our maintenance budgets so that we're able to look after our rural and regional state highways to a better standard as well.
The GPS has pulled money from public transport, although public transport patronage data shows that it's almost back up to pre-COVID levels now. Is it your expectation that it will ultimately result in a reduction of public transport services?
No, not at all. This is about making sure that there's a balance between how much different parts of the transport system are paying. Private share has reduced from about 40% of the funding to about 13%. And so we want to get the balance right. From the data that I've been given from the New Zealand Transport Agency, last year they provided about $500 million in NZTA share towards public transport operations in the country. And I point that out because the range that we've provided in the GPS is between $400 and $700 million.
Right.
So we have a range which will adequately support the public transport services that New Zealand
expect. But again, the funding is cut relative to the previous GPS, the previous government's GPS.
Previous government's draft GPS.
Yes. So if your government won't make up that shortfall, and I appreciate there's a range.
I'm just saying there's not a shortfall because the current financial year, NZTA is providing around $500 million. The range we provide is $400 to $700 million. What they will be spending is well within the range.
In order to continue services as they are today, either councils will have to further fund those or we should expect public transport fares to increase.
Well, ultimately, we've provided a range which we believe will provide that reliable service that New Zealanders need.
There's there today. Nothing's going to change. We're not going to see public transport fares increase.
Well, as I said, this year it's $500 million from what I've been told. The range is $400 to $700 million. So there's actually room for growth.
Okay.
But I'd also point out, councils do have to make sure they're getting the private share up. There's multiple ways they can do that. Increased patronage, fare box, also advertising. They need to do a better job.
Congestion charging?
Yes.
Everyone seems to agree on it. Are we going to see it this term?
Absolutely. It's part of one of our coalition agreements.
It will be
ACT
in place this term?
Well, we're moving at pace around getting the legislation ready for that.
And you think on the balance of likelihood, appreciating that stuff takes a long time to actually get through
Parliament? Well, ultimately, there's two steps. Firstly, we need to pass legislation. We're working at pace around preparing that. The second step is then those councils which wish to implement it need to go through a process to implement it as well. So I'm talking with the Mayor of Auckland about this. He's obviously very interested. We want to make sure this is about giving, people who pay a congestion charge get something for it, which is a shorter journey time, a more reliable journey time. That's going to be the key focus of it.
Very good. Okay. After the break, one of the government's first moves in office was to scrap Three Waters. So what's going to take its place? Hawke Mai, welcome back. Three Waters is dead, nixed as part of the Coalition Government's 100-day plan. So what comes next? Simeon Brown is the Minister for Local Government. What are the next steps in introducing a replacement for Three Waters?
Well, as you said, we've repealed the last government's co-governed mega-entity approach, which many councils across the country rejected. We're now implementing what we call Local Water Done Well, which is about providing councils the ability to have financial sustainable approaches to water infrastructure. I don't think anyone's denying the fact that we need to have a more financially sustainable approach to water infrastructure in New Zealand. We've got huge challenges ahead of us. We want to have the funding and the funding tools available for local government to be able to make those decisions and make those long-term investments they need to do.
Okay, three very simple yes or no's. Number one, will your government put any new money in to support councils get their water up to scratch?
Well, we're focused on making sure they've got the funding and financing tools to be able
yes
to do
no.
that.
So is there going to be any new money?
Well, we're not putting capital in. The last government didn't either.
Yeah. Number two, will you give councils any new money in order to establish the CCO entities?
Well, we're working through some options around some of that, but I can't.
But that's a possibility. It's something you're considering.
Well, ultimately, there is some money remaining from the last government's reforms.
Yeah.
We're looking at some options around that, but I can't give any answers right here.
And will the government underwrite the debt of those CCOs in the future?
No, that's not our intent. We've made that very clear through this process.
Do you accept that rates will have to significantly increase in order to deliver services that meet the regulatory requirements as they stand?
No, because ultimately what we're focused on here is giving councils the long-term funding and financing tools that they need. And there's a range of options that could work. For some councils, I met with Ron Mark, who's the Mayor of Carterton yesterday, And he said, look, we're good till the 2040s in terms of we've made prudent decisions, we've invested, and we're in a really good position.
What about Tararua, just up the road?
Well, exactly. Other councils are in a more challenging circumstance. So we're going to require councils. So we've got legislation coming to Parliament in the middle of this year, which will require councils to put forward a water service delivery plan, which will show over the next 10 years, 30 years, what their plans are and how they intend to have a financially sustainable approach to it. Now, some councils might join together in a regional CCO to do that. Others might want to work with the local government funding agency to see how they can have borrowing, which is tied to their water revenues. We're going to make sure that all water revenue is ring-fenced to go back into water, but there'll be a range of ways that councils will approach that financially sustainable model.
So how do we know that when councils are preparing those plans, especially the councils that are in more dire positions at the moment, won't just say, yep, well, we can meet all these requirements, but we have to significantly increase rates?
Yeah, well, we're going to have three tests for it.
That's a possibility.
So one will be we want to make sure the money's ring-fenced, make sure it's sufficient and affordable. And the third one is we'll make sure they're funding for growth. And so they will have to start, you know, a number of councils, and they're already talking about how they can have a regional council-controlled organisation, which gets that scale, means it's an affordable, you spread the cost of that infrastructure over a longer period of time. You have a user-pays approach, which means
the question is whether or not some councils, depending on the state of their water infrastructure, will have to really massively increase rates and forecast those increases in rates in order to achieve what you are requiring them to achieve under their long-term plans.
Well, ultimately, they'll be working with other councils around that as well.
Some of them will be, right?
And we'll have a regulatory backstop. So if they're unable or unwilling in terms of putting forward that plan, which meets those tests, we will have a regulatory backstop, which will allow the government to step in.
So Simon Watts appeared on the show last year once you first introduced your Three Waters alternative plan. Here's what he had to say in February 2023.
What will your plan do to the cost of water bills and for rates?
So our view is that it's definitely going to, under our model, rates are not going to increase. Are not going to increase in comparison to Labor's Three Waters model and the status quo.
So for the record, this term, this parliamentary term, will water costs for ratepayers be higher than they would have been under the previous government's plan?
Well, the councils are going through their long-term planning process at the moment, as you know, and they are facing significant challenges. We're facing significant challenges as well through with its increased cost of infrastructure, interest rates,
answer this question, please. Yep. So will water costs for ratepayers this term be higher than they would have been under the previous government's plan?
Well, the previous government's reforms weren't going to come into effect until 2026.
That's why I ask.
For the vast majority of councils. So the reality is we're actually working at pace. Here we're going to have our reforms fully legislated by middle of 2025.
Again, that doesn't answer the question. Will water costs for ratepayers this term potentially be higher than they would have been under the previous government's plan?
Well, what we're doing
is... It's a really straight question. Please just answer that question.
Well, we're very focused on making sure we have an affordable approach, providing councils the ability to make...
It doesn't answer
those
the question.
Long-term,
it's a very simple
those
question. It's a binary.
...into water infrastructure.
I'm going to ask it one more time.
Ratepayers.
Will water costs for ratepayers this term, as your previous spokesperson promised, will they this term potentially be higher than they would have been under the previous government's plans?
No, they won't be. And the reality is, I'd say, is we are focused on giving the long-term funding and financing tools to local government so they can make those investments. And you know, if you think about the Infrastructure Funding and Financing Act, whether that's having off-balance sheet special purpose vehicles to make those investments and spread that cost over a longer period of time, we're very focused on providing a range of funding and financing tools to help councils make those investments and also ensure that cost is spread over a longer period of time to keep the cost down for ratepayers.
And that they have economies of scale, right?
Well, and that's through the CCO model.
CCO models, basically, where councils can come together to try and achieve economies of scale. So why would a big council with good infrastructure join together and effectively subsidise a council that has crappy water infrastructure?
Well, the reality is we're going to ask all councils to work together.
Are you going to mandate that?
Well, they will be putting forward their plans for water service delivery plans.
Councils have a statutory requirement, right, to act in the interest of their ratepayers. You agree with that, right?
Yes, they do.
So why would a big council with really good water infrastructure want to join up with another small council that doesn't?
Because ultimately, even if you think of Tauranga and Hamilton, right, they're going to need to have get economies of scale if they were to work together. They're going to need to find economies of scale. That means actually having enough people and enough users within that scheme to be able to achieve that.
And so let's look at the South Island East Coast.
I've been around the country this week. I've met with mayors in the South Island, Lower North Island, East Coast. All of the mayors are very focused on how they're going to work together to solve this problem.
So here's what the mayor of Buller, Jamie Klein, told the press. He said that West Coast mayors had considered joining up to make effectively a CCO under the previous government's plans, but found no advantage or economies of scale. Quote, "We would need to approach Canterbury or Tasman mayors. I'm absolutely open to that, but I'm cognizant we would be bringing an unpalatable business case to the table." So my question is, if councils don't join together, will your government mandate they do so?
Well, I say we will have a regulatory backstop.
Does it mean mandating them to work together?
It could mean that we will have step-in powers like we do under the Local Government Act, where under the Local Government Act, the minister can appoint a commissioner. So there will be step-in powers.
Would that be mandating, though? So take that West Coast example. Would you say, Canterbury, you've got to pick up the bill for the West Coast?
Well, it would be effectively to require those councils to work together,
right?
And so we don't want to see councils left behind, but we also want to see councils take responsibility for these conversations. Sure. And so I don't want
you
to
want
have,
them to lead it.
I don't want to have to use a regulatory step in power. It'll be a similar intervention to when electricity reforms were done in the 90s, where there were step in powers put in place. Then they were never used.
Yeah. It's not really local water done well, though, is it? It's not really local if you're mandating councils against their will.
It's a backstop. It's a backstop to ensure that we can ensure that we have a financially sustainable approach. But ultimately, it leaves these assets in councils' hands, which is what they've been asking for. And we're giving them the ability to put forward their plans to make those long-term investments.
Balance sheet separation, this accounting term that gets thrown around the whole time with this conversation, the ability of the new CCOs to effectively separate their balance sheets from councils. So under your model, will you guarantee that all councils and CCOs in New Zealand will achieve balance sheet separation?
Well, I just point out that's one way to achieve financial sustainability for water infrastructure. I mean, if you think about some councils which have done a really good job, they may well be able to manage those costs within the existing framework. So that's one tool. The other tool is putting together a regional CCO, which is then able to use to leverage the revenues to be able to borrow against those revenues and make those investments without necessarily requiring balance sheet separation.
Right.
In some instances, particularly here in Auckland, that financial separation will be critical because it can't partner with other councils in order to do that.
So I just want to know, under your legislation, will you guarantee that all new CCOs will have the ability to achieve balance sheet separation?
Well, we're going to provide the ability through legislation for that to be an option, but it's not necessarily going to be necessary because there'll be a range of different ways in which councils
will it be achievable? Will you guarantee that it will be achievable for CCOs?
What we want to make achievable is financial sustainability.
My focus is balance sheet separation.
So
give us a straight answer on that. Will you guarantee that all new CCOs will be able to achieve balance sheet separation under your legislation?
Well, the second piece of legislation we'll be bringing to the House at the end of this year will make changes around the council-controlled organisation legislative framework model in order for that financial separation to happen. So whether that's requiring no guarantees from councils.
But you won't make that guarantee this morning, though, that they can all get balance sheet separation.
Well, that's the intention of the second piece of legislation we're bringing to Parliament later this year. At the moment, we're working very closely with Auckland, in particular regarding water care, to ensure we get that for Auckland Council. So that's where we're at the moment. And the piece of legislation we bring at the end of this year, we focused on that model and making sure that
you can achieve that. You won't make that guarantee this
morning. We want to have a model which can achieve that. But I'm just saying...
But I'm asking guarantees.
The financial sustainability doesn't necessarily require that because there are other... The local government funding agency...
I appreciate you're saying it might not be necessary. I get that. I'm asking, nonetheless, if your legislation will guarantee that all of them will do it.
Correct.
Okay. Are the drinking water standards required under Taumata Arawai too onerous?
Well, when we were in opposition, we did make the point around the rural drinking suppliers. There's a large number of very small rural drinking suppliers, which the regulatory burden is quite significant, so we will look at that. But ultimately, we are committed to high-quality water infrastructure. Mm. We want to make sure it's over a time frame which is deliverable and achievable, but we are committed to high-quality water for New Zealanders, which is safe to drink.
You are considering sharing GST with councils on new developments. To be clear, would councils have to wait for a development to be completed before getting the share of GST?
Well, that's a piece of piece of work that my colleague Chris Bishop's focused on in terms of the options that we've got around that. That's a coalition commitment with the ACT Party to explore a revenue sharing type arrangement. The details have been worked through. We don't have any particular answers around what that would look like right now. But we are committed to working with councils to support those councils which are achieving above historical levels of housing development so we can incentivise growth in New Zealand.
Thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it. Minister for Local Government, Simeon Brown.